for the History of Society lecture series. Then we have George Bodie, who's sitting right here. He is a second year PhD student in Slavonic and Eastern European Studies at UCL. His focus is the German Democratic Republic, the Global South, and Decolonization. He did his MA at UCL European History and his BA at Sussex. And he's worked and conducted research in the Federal Archives in Berlin. So we have this very cool presentation today. We hope you guys all enjoy it. And hand over to George. Thank you so much for being here.
Yeah, thanks for having me. I'm not using this mic. I don't think I need to. I don't think anyone can hear me. Yeah. You can't hear me, just to tell you something. So yeah, thanks for having me here. Thanks as a this is a project first and foremost about the German Democratic Republic, so I'm aware to some degree I'm kind of speaking to those outside of my field. So for those who don't know or aren't really familiar with it, the German Democratic Republic was a state that former East Germany, it's often referred to as the former East Germany. It was a state installed by the Soviet Union after the First World War, officially established in 1949, and existed until the fall of the Berlin Wall. In 1989, it was technically dissolved into Federal Germany in 1990. But I was particularly keen to speak here at SOAS because my project is also about the GDR in a kind of broader international context, in particular its relationship with Global South. Research network that I've gone to speak about a bit, but the research network that I'm part of is about putting the socialist world in conversation with Global South, but it's kind of a project that's been largely consigned to Eastern European Studies departments or socialist departments. So it's great to kind of come here and speak to people who study the Global South specifically. So my project aims at providing new historical insight into both the importance of the Global South to the GDR and to a lesser extent the role the GDR played in the development of the Global South after the Second World War, particularly following decolonisation. I'm aware that the Global South is an area that is huge, heterogeneous, difficult to draw together. So I'm going to begin by kind of justifying my usage of this term, the concept more broadly. So as I mentioned, my project is part of a broader one. It's an Arts and Humanities Research Council-funded research network of Socialist and Global. I thought I'd start by reading their mission statement, our mission statement, to provide some context. So, post-World War II, as both decolonisation and new forms of globalisation accelerated, new linkages opened up and existing ties were remade between what was once called the Second World from the Soviet Union to the GDR and the Third World from Latin America to Africa to Asia. Contacts multiplied through, for instance, the development of political bonds, economic development and aid, health and cultural and academic projects, as well as military intervention. Yet these important encounters and their impacts on national, regional, and global histories have hitherto only played a marginal role in accounts of late 20th century globalisation, which have mainly focused on links between the West and their former colonies, or between the countries of the Global South. There is still very little study of the interaction between these areas, but commonly shared and contested beliefs in the power of socialist modernisation and anti-imperial culture opened up possibilities of meaningful political, cultural, and economic transfers during the Cold War and its aftermath. This project seeks to provide new insights into the circulation of ideas during the Cold War and to explore the socialist world to that dynamic hub of global interactions during the second half of the 20th century. So this is a project largely about the socialist world, but one that recognises the huge importance of the Global South to the socialist world. And whilst, yes, the Socialism Goes Global project uses the term Third World, I'll be using the term Global South here for a number of reasons. One is, of course, the stigma attached to the term Third World. And historians, Cold War historians, often critical of using the term Global South when speaking about the Cold War because it's anachronistic, it wasn't used by the answer at the time. I would suggest that so too is the third world, which was a term almost exclusively used in the West during the Cold War. The leaders of the non-aligned movement, for example, refer to themselves as third world leaders, to the best of my knowledge. And whilst the free world theory, which states that the first world is what we today would call the global north, so Europe, US, various other rich capitalist countries, the second world being the socialist world, so the Soviet bloc, the Soviet Union, and the states in Eastern Europe, and the third world being everywhere else. I think whilst the third world, the free world theory provides a helpful scheme to try and rethink the Cold War history without excessive focus on bipolarity between the US and the Soviet Union. There is no evidence that members of the socialist world saw themselves as operating within such a schema. And I've never encountered a former citizen of the GDR who has not expressed surprise and usually offence at the idea that they are actually members of a second, not the first world. What about the problem of heterogeneity? Of course, any such grouping is problematic, much as the term global south appears to kind of obscure the differences between a wide range of different countries, diverse as Peru, Togo, and Vietnam. So too, the term second world or socialist world blurs the distinctions between entities diverse as the German Democratic Republic, or, for example, the Tajik Soviet Socialist Republic. So my intention here is not to present the global south as a kind of coagulated homogenous mass, simply to point out that in the Cold War, any nation that didn't stand under the direct control of either the Soviets or the US had to negotiate the global conditions thrown up by their confrontation. And thus the most important battlegrounds of the Cold War, as most Cold War historians would now recognize, were precisely within these states, Cuba, Angola, and Vietnam. Such a poor focus is also informed by the way that the leaders of the GDR saw the world. In official parlance, GDR functionaries divided the world up into the following categories. The so-called socialist brother countries, which represented the Soviet Union, and what was called the people's democracies in the Soviet bloc, so Hungary, Poland, etc. The capitalist world, which represents the kind of rich countries of the global north, and in what they call the non-capitalist world, which was essentially everyone else. As national liberation struggles in Africa in particular began to make tens of new nation states in the late 1950s and early 1960s, this non-capitalist world began to take on increasing importance in worldviews of GDR leaders. My project is about how these struggles changed the GDR, how the leaders of the GDR tried to work these developments into their existing ideological frameworks, but it's also about how actors from the global south disrupted, confirmed, or upended these frameworks. So the links between the GDR and the global south fell under the rubric of socialist internationalism. But what was socialist internationalism? I contend here that socialist internationalism was hugely important to the GDR, so the GDR's commitment to international solidarity was a constituent part of its ideological foundation. All GDR youth had to take the Jugendweihe, which was a kind of secular coming of age ceremony, and during this they were implored to struggle in the spirit of proletarian internationalism. Ruling Socialist Unity Party, which ruled the GDR throughout its existence, the SED, had commitments to Leninist internationalism in its founding documents, and internationalism was part of the GDR's constitution. Article 6 of the GDR constitution stated that the GDR, quote, supported all states and peoples who struggle for national freedom and independence against imperialism and its colonial regime. This is a poster for the World Youth Festival in 1973, the GDR. In 1963, GDR head of state Walter Ulbricht published the 10 Commandments of Socialist Morals and Ethics, which was intended to replace the biblical Ten Commandments. There's a poster of it in German, and it's a translation. And I think it's interesting that both the first and last commandments contained kind of commandments towards socialist internationalism. So thou shalt always defend the international solidarity of the working class, as well as the permanent bond to the United States socialist countries. Number 10, Thou Shalt Exhibit Solidarity with all those people who are fighting for national liberation and defending their independence. In much of the existing literature, GDR solidarity with the Global South has been conceptualised as a tool for the SED's international interests. Because the GDR was a kind of enforced state, it was a state that suffered from a perpetual legitimacy deficit, it's what it's called a legitimacy deficit. So solidarity has been argued to serve the GDR in the following three ways. First, it was intended to improve the GDR's image abroad. Secondly, it was supposed to distinguish it from West Germany. And third, it was a way of mobilising a kind of apathetic population. This literature has pointed to broad truths about the nature of socialist internationalism in the GDR as being, in the words of one scholar, a means of challenging personal activism within a framework defined by the state. Although this isn't to say that it couldn't be a mass popular phenomenon. So one example of this is the way that money for solidarity initiatives were raised. This is the symbol of the Solidarity Committee, which was set up in 1960. Most of the funding for the Solidarity Committee was raised through donations, and these donations from GDR citizens were organised in the workplace by the Trade Union Federation, which is now CFDGB. The donated amounts were surprisingly large. So in the 1980s, levels of 0.82% GDP were raised. To put that into perspective, the UN aid spending target for aid for states today is 0.7% GDP, something that the UK, for example, rarely achieves. We know very little about the circumstances surrounding these donations, and whilst there was an element of compulsion involved, particularly for members of the party, some solidarity initiatives were genuinely popular. There's two particular ones I want to speak about now. The first is the Vietnamese solidarity campaign. So the impact of the Vietnam War is well known and has been well documented kind of beyond Vietnam, particularly in the West. There's a lot of work, for example, on the impact it had on the left in France or in student movements in the US, for example. But very little is known about the effect that it had on socialism. That the Vietnamese success had on the leaders of the socialist bloc. For the leaders of the Soviet bloc, the Vietnamese defeat of the US was both a signal that the world was turning their own way in the Cold War, that they were winning the Cold War, but it was also perceived of as a threat. Similarly to the way that the Cuban Revolution was perceived as by kind of Soviet leaders and socialist leaders in Europe as both youthful, so therefore able to kind of breathe new life into a stagnant socialist project. Also, on the same terms, kind of a threat because it was difficult to control and potentially highlighted the kind of stagnancy of these socialist states. Therefore, aid for Vietnam was both about support for force that was being seen as genuinely comradely. It was also about a desire to appear as a sort of elder statesman that would guide the youth revolution towards modernization. Vietnam was probably the most popular of all the GDR solidarity campaigns, and Vietnam was by quite some distance the biggest recipient of GDR solidarity spending. So most of this spending was funded by the sale of stamps, and the stamps you can see here are from the CFARS Vietnam, which is Invincible Vietnam series, which ran from 1966 to 1975. Alongside this, so these were kind of essentially kind of form of socialist gift aid. People would buy stamps, and half or a third of the money would be given to these solidarity initiatives. Alongside this, spending was administered by a dedicated Vietnam committee, which ran individual campaigns to deliver blood or bicycles or sewing machines to Vietnam. And after the war, the GDR engaged with the Vietnamese government for the rebuilding of the city of Binh, which to this day contains an East German residential quarter. Towards the end of the century, these relationships took on increasingly more economic overtones, which is something I'll discuss in more detail later. I just wanted to speak a bit about, here's another postcard from the Invincible Vietnam series. I wanted to speak a little bit about the imagery of these campaigns. So if you see in the Invincible Vietnam series, it's mostly women, armed women. But here you see on the left, this is a famous poster that's produced, that was widely produced, it's still quite common to see it in Berlin today. It's a Solidarity in Siegen, which means Solidarity of Victory. I think what's interesting about this particular poster is that, in contrast with the stamps, it reveals the kind of dual symbolism that was at work in a lot of this Solidarity material. So this poster kind of conforms to long-established conventions of Western European aid appeals. So there's you see a kind of an imagery of victimhood, of kind of helplessness. But interestingly, this kind of sat alongside depictions of fighters and armed people engaged in struggle. And I think it's quite interesting, quite telling about how these solidarity campaigns function, that these kind of dual contradictory images of victimhood both and also fighting and armed struggle kind of seem to sit together without any kind of recognition of their contradiction. The photo on the right is from a Vietnam Solidarity March in Berlin. The second campaign I want to speak about here is the anti-apartheid campaign. The two posters, both campaigning for freedom for Nelson Mandela. The GDR is not often recognised, it's quite an important player in anti-apartheid struggles. This partially was a result of historical accident, so the collapse of the Portuguese Empire in the mid-1970s came at a time of newfound international self-confidence for the GDR. Following years of international isolation caused by the West German Hauptstein Doctrine, which stated that West Germany would cut all ties with any nation that recognised the GDR. Détente in the Cold War allowed the GDR to gain admission to the UN, and West Germany under Willy Brandt and the Doctrine of Ostpolitik moved away from the Hauptstein Doctrine, so allowing the GDR to kind of move out and make official diplomatic relations with the rest of the world. Thus, many of its most important links came with the nations that had overthrown the Portuguese Empire, so particularly Angola and Mozambique were important. And the GDR also forged important links with Namibian national liberation movements. Namibia, of course, was once a German colony in South Africa, and this was hugely important. Official GDR ideology stated that whilst the GDR was an anti-racist, anti-imperialist state, its West German neighbour was a continuation of German colonialism in the form of neo-colonialism. This is a claim not without good reason. Many of the prominent figures in the post-war West German African societies were ex-colonialists, not least West German president Konrad Adenauer himself. But the German colonial past, or rather the attempt to distance themselves from it, was particularly important in the GDR. This took many forms. GDR scholars, for example, were some of the first scholars in Europe to use German colonial archives to uncover German colonial crimes, or at least to expose them to European audiences. One of the most prominent examples of this is the Herero genocide, which happened in the early 20th century in Southwest Africa. Yet, at the same time, I'd say the GDR functionaries were also very cautious about focusing too much on and evidence I've seen from the archive regarding particular relations between SWAPO, the Namibian National Liberation Movement, and the GDR kind of reveals that the colonial past was something more often raised by African activists than it was the other way around. So anti-apartheid activism came to prominence in GDR solidarity campaigns in the 1980s. There's one particular campaign I'd like to highlight which kind of reveals the prominence of these solidarity campaigns played in everyday life for GDR citizens. In 1986, GDR children's magazine Gumi initiated a campaign to send then imprisoned Nelson Mandela birthday cards for his 68th birthday. The magazine claimed that, I quote, "You would give his heart strength. The more we send, the bigger the trouble for his prison guards. They will be scared of you. You are so many. They are scared that they must scream Mandela." Bumi received 80,000 postcards in the following 3 weeks. Anti-apartheid support could also be practical, so the ANC's official organ, Sachalba, was printed in the GDR and flown to various locations with funds raised from solidarity donations. So whilst GDR solidarity initiatives could be genuinely popular, they were also never free from the interests of the state. So for example, despite officially boycotting apartheid South Africa, GDR used third parties to trade with the apartheid state until anti-apartheid activists revealed this practice. And in particular, the utilisation of solidarity for economic interests became important from the late 1970s onwards. So one interesting point of convergence between the global south and the socialist world, I think, is the global debt crisis, which came after 1973. So it was kind of caused by a conjunction of an OPEC price hike, which drove global oil prices up, recycling and subsequent profits into cheap loans by Western banks, coupled with a high inflation rate of the dollar. It's well known that this global debt crisis had on the countries of the global south, although it's not often recognised that the socialist world found itself in exactly the same boat. By the 1980s, both socialist countries and those in the global south had built up huge debts to Western debtors. And the need for hard currency would come to define GDR foreign policy in this period. So whilst GDR was never immune from claims by global south actors, that when involved in the production and procurement of raw materials, it was exploitative. For example, in 1963, the General Secretary of the Chilean Communist Party accused the GDR trying to exploit the Chilean people for its own benefit, when SED officials suggested creating a German-Chilean joint enterprise company for copper production. From the late 1970s onward, however, solidarity practices in the GDR became intimately bound up in this drive to obtain hard currency. So solidarity became increasingly dependent on what sort of trade cooperation. This was most apparent during the coffee crisis of the GDR, which is particularly important for the history of the state. In 1977, an inability to import coffee, thanks to a lack of hard currency reserves and rising coffee prices, led to shortages. The GDR state was forced to ration coffee, creating an infamous coffee mix. Signed with Vietnam to revive French colonial era coffee plantations in Dak Lak in Vietnam. GDR built a power station, housing, schools and hospitals for the new plantation. GDR experts were sent to Vietnam, I think interestingly stayed in the French era colonial mansions. And in total, GDR investment reached almost $20 million. In return, the GDR was to receive half of all Vietnamese coffee production. But by the time the plantation was up and running in the 1990s, the GDR had ceased to exist. Ironically, the plantation would go on to become the nucleus of a thriving Vietnamese coffee industry, which made it the world's second biggest producer of coffee in the 2000s. And what the GDR officials called mutual interest was also apparent in the rise of Vertragsarbeiter or contract workers who came to work for the GDR from the global south in the 1980s, principally from Vietnam, Angola, and Mozambique. Plight of these workers is one of the better researched areas of GDR solidarity practices, and it's here where a discourse of solidarity was most clearly deployed as a cloak for economically exploitative practices. The GDR government, unwilling to highlight the reality of their own economic problems, portrayed these agreements as signs of fraternal cooperation, a description not borne out in the treatment of workers who were isolated, segregated, became victims of a rise of racism in the GDR in the 1980s. And their supervision was profoundly paternalistic. And I think we might think about the kind of how essentially it's a different. It's difficult to separate this practice from any other kind of state organised form of exploitation of cheap labour, particularly I think the guest workers came to work in West Germany in 1980. So how does this history of socialist internationalism contribute to a notion of socialist globalisation? Can we speak about the notion of socialist globalisation? Whilst the existence of socialist internationalism in its varied forms has challenged multiple narratives of an immobile socialist world that was impervious to outside contact, this challenge is combined with new non-Eurocentric conceptions of the Cold War, which have sought to shed light on the connections and relationships between the socialist world and the global self. Ironically, though, as I mentioned, these challenges remain provincialised within their own departments. The notion of a kind of socialist globalisation is not yet said to have been to have successfully entered broader narratives of globalisation and global studies. Most of the historians who work on this come from Eastern European or from Soviet studies backgrounds. So this section will highlight the attempts of free scholars who have tried to kind of integrate these interactions into a broader global stories of globalisation. And I argue that these three approaches can be categorised into a generative approach, which is associated with the work of Johann Bockmann, a parallel approach, which is owing to the work of Lukas Stanek, and a limited approach from the work of Oscar Sanchez-Sivinova. So the generative approach is Johann Bockmann's. Bockmann claims that globalisation was in fact a process initially produced by actors from the socialist sphere and the global south, particularly focusing on UNCTAD, which was the United Nations Conference on Trade and Development, rather than a project being begun by the United States, which spread east and southwards. Bockmann claims that globalisation was instead produced by these forces against the active opposition of the US and the old colonial powers, who sought to maintain the status quo of the colonial system. According to Bockmann, the socialist world and the global self are thus the true progenitors of globalisation, a process taken on by neoliberalism only later. The second is the work of Lukas Stanek, who has sought to differentiate between socialist mondialisation, which is a concept that's taken from Henri Lefebvre, creating what I would call the parallel approach. According to Stanek, mondialisation refers to the emergence of global practices that convey competing ways of becoming worldly, alternative visions of the world as a whole, plural imaginations. Under this rubric, what we know of as globalisation is simply synonymous with neoliberalism and is just one of the many possibilities of mondialisation, with socialist internationalism being another. Stanek's work focuses particularly on architectural change between the socialist world and African countries and argues against prevailing narratives that see a kind of post-unilateral 1989, post-1989 expansion of architectural groups. The third argument of note here is the work of Oscar Sanchez-Sivony, whose approach I call the limited. In his polemical book Red Globalization, Sanchez-Sivony makes three substantial claims. Firstly, that the Soviet Union was embedded in the structures of the global economy much more substantially than previously was thought. Secondly, that the Soviet Union was never close to achieving parity with the US in economic terms. And thirdly, that Soviet relations with the global south were driven more by the leaders of the global south than they were by the leaders of the Soviet Union. Ultimately, Sanchez-Sivony argues that the Soviet Union was a cautious, reluctant, and weak actor seeking to find its place within the structures of US hegemonic processes of globalization. So, scholars claiming the existence of any such kind of notion of socialist globalization face numerous possible objections. In Discipline of International Relations, for example, Justin Rosenberg has argued that globalisation theory itself is an illusion, dependent on a sense of global interconnectedness that followed the collapse of the Soviet Union and the vacuum that it left behind. Any notion of socialist globalisation thus runs the risk of anachronism, ascribing equality to the socialist world that some scholars see existing only due to its rapid downfall. Furthermore, in order to claim that the socialist world and the global south together were progenitors of the process we could call globalisation, requires that we first ascertain what globalisation actually is. And even in the social sciences today, there exists no cogent theory of globalisation. identified as capitalism's tendencies towards universalization, expansion, and deterritorialization. So while such objections call for caution, I think the dual task of situating social self connections within broader transnational processes and interrogating their under-examined importance to both social societies and to the global south remains pressing. While it may be early yet to speak of a clearly definable process of socialist globalization, the three proposals listed here, I suggest, offer useful insights into the systematic, globally contextual nature of socialist self-connections. Firstly, whilst Johanna Bockmann's sweeping claims regarding socialist self-connections being the true drivers of capitalist globalization are probably overambitious, it is true that the socialist and post-colonial worlds were in many respects novel. Connections were formed in many respects novel and have survived the decline of the Soviet world. Secondly, following the static, an important element of these connections is that they were in some cases self-consciously parallel to what historical actors saw as transnational, US-led forms of neo-imperialist or neo-colonial power. This could carry a multitude of meanings, but the most dominant strand, I think, of this is the attempt to frame socialist self-connections mutually beneficial and non-exploitative relationships. This second element is tempered by a third, however, following Sanchez Siboney. They were limited by the socialist world's comparative disadvantage of the West, as well as a lack of foreign currency, as we've spoken about in the GDR. And this limitation is an important factor in another defining element of social self-connections, the Sino-Soviet split. So recent research has pointed to the ideological roots of the Sino-Soviet split, suggesting that at its heart lay a fundamental schism with regard to how to deal with an imperialist West, and scholars investigating the Cold War from a perspective increasingly decentered from Europe pointed to the importance of this schism increasingly in Cold War studies. So now I can move on to my case study. So whilst I would say it remains early yet, we speak about something called socialist globalization as distinct from other forms of globalization. My own research thus far has focused on the experience of students in the global south who came to study in the GDR in the 1960s during the high point of decolonization in Africa. In particular, I've looked at the experiences of students at the Fritz Becker Trade Union University, which founded an institute for foreign students in 1959 and went on to teach roughly 4,400 unionists from 93 different states. So whilst the definition of foreign here was very broad, there were some Europeans that studied at the university, it was principally for students in the global south. Particularly in the 1960s, the kind of importance of decolonisation movements in Africa meant that the institute was principally focused on educating African students and in kind of learning and teaching about Africa. I'm interested mainly in the ideological debates that were had at this university and what this tells us about the period. So in terms of globalization, the presence of these students in the socialist world are an example of how decolonization itself contributed to globalization. So globalization and decolonization have quite a difficult, more often presented, as not necessarily being aspects of the same phenomenon. Narratives often present decolonization as a sort of reactive globalization. Anti-colonial insurgencies and wars have usually been viewed as a symptom, not a cause, of fundamental changes in international relations precipitated by other more Eurocentric factors. So scholars have often claimed that the globalizing factor here was the establishment of empire, and that decolonization movements were simply reactive forces that didn't produce new globalizing forces, but simply were reacting against these kind of Eurocentric factors. In opposition to this, I argue that the globalizing forces of decolonization were just as important and profound, if not more, than those created by empire. Globalization stopped during the years of decolonization, but it began to work instead differently. The transnational networks, cross-cultural borrowings, and observed precedents that sustained the forces of anti-colonial nationalism insurgency and popular protest were in themselves globalizing factors. Because anti-colonial conflicts were generally characterized by a massive imbalance of power between the colonial state and anti-colonial insurgents. Anti-colonial activists were driven to maximize their potential by building regional networks of support and publicizing their cause internationally. In the global context, words and images in the form of publicity campaigns at the UN, lobbying for aid from sympathetic powers, and targeted propaganda in the press and television media became vital weapons for anti-colonial fighters, helping to reverse the military imbalances between insurgent forces and their opponents. So there's two key books, I think, for this argument, both by Chris Gosher and Matt Colony. So Chris Gosher talks about the importance of these transnational networks with Vietnamese independence fighters, particularly with reference to Thailand. And Matthew Colony's work on the FLN has pointed to the transnational diplomatic networks that the FLN set up during the Algerian War of National Liberation. So these were the ways which the weak won the battles of decolonization, because they were better than the militarily strong in maintaining transnational networks of support, especially in economic and diplomatic terms. So whilst decolonization saw the socialist world turn to the global south, the actual links that developed between these worlds were mostly initiated by global south actors themselves, and not vice versa. The GDR trade union, the FDGB, had established contacts with 30 trade unions in Africa throughout 1960, which the UN had designated the Year of Africa, following the independence of 17 African nations in that year. Stipends for students were paid for by solidarity donations, which were arranged through these union connections. This lasted 18 months, 7 to 8 months at the beginning, set aside for German language training. And the rest was being devoted to what was called a basic education. This was covered in 5 key areas, which were class politics, imperialism, colonialism, histories of workers' movements in the global south, and the importance of the Soviet Union and the Soviet Revolution, and the organizational principles of artisan trade unions. At the end, a written exam is taken, followed by an oral exam, and students were expected to answer some of these questions. There's 50 questions, this is the first 20. So as you can see, they kind of contain a mix of quite heavy Marxist theory, but also a kind of desire that students would produce certain political standpoints. For example, question 16 proved that the European Economic Community is an instrument of neo-colonialism. With regard to these outlined arguments of the globalizing features of decolonization, I'd like to highlight the ideological debates that surrounded one particular color war at the university between the years 1961 and 1963. This cohort was made up of 95 students from 20 different countries. It was 18 African countries and 2 Asian. FDGB reports suggested that 90% of these students came from peasant backgrounds, 5% from the intelligentsia, and 5% from working families from the workers' background. Over half of them were trade unionists and already had experience of trade unionism. The students arrived at particularly kind of interesting stage of the world, shortly after the building of Berlin in 1961. In October, Cold War tensions came to a head with Soviet and US tanks involved in a standoff at Checkpoint Charlie in Berlin. December saw Fidel Castro declare his fidelity to Marxism and Leninism in a speech in Havana. And perhaps most notably, 1961-62 saw an escalation in the Sino-Soviet split, which was the split between the Soviet Union and Maoist China. And the most noteworthy cause of this was the Cuban Missile Crisis in October 1962, as well as numerous smaller incidents which contributed to this divide, such as the Indian liberation of Goa in December 1961 and the Himalayan border war between China and India in September and November, between September and November of 1962. The most important event for this cohort, however, was the Cuban Missile Crisis. Earlier in the year, clashes could already be detected between the kind of global interests of anti-imperialism and the foreign policy interests of the GDR, particularly with regard to the GDR's membership of the United Nations. The communist world's insistence on using the channels of the UN rather than intervening directly during the Congo crisis, for example, was widely condemned by African students. As the secretary of the African Students' Union in the GDR noted in early 1963, the imperialist powers still maintain supremacy in the UN, meaning the Soviet Union's attempt to save Patrice Lumumba following his arrest ended in failure. This meant, as he put it, and I quote, "Through the socialist state's application of peaceful coexistence, the progressive development of the Congo was beaten back, Lumumba was murdered, and the liberation movements in Africa were delivered a huge blow. This could not have happened had the USSR and other socialist states acted." Here, this was a reference to the doctrine of peaceful coexistence, which was a Soviet doctrine. It was announced by Khrushchev in 1956, and the idea was that nuclear war had made what had previously been Soviet policy, was that there would be a military conflict between capitalism and communism was inevitable. Khrushchev stated that the existence of nuclear weapons had made this prospect unthinkable, and therefore the conflict between capitalism and socialism would have to be fought out on the basis of culture and economy. The notion of peaceful coexistence was attempted, the socialist world attempted to sell the notion of peaceful coexistence to the global south on the basis that disarmament would free up funds for development, in turn freeing newly independent states from the shackles and dangers of Western development aid and its corollary neo-colonialism. Distilling a belief in peaceful coexistence was a huge part of the Institute curriculum. But the Congo crisis, which began in 1960 and continued on for the first half of the decade, with its key moment being the murder of the Congolese leader, Patrice Lumumba, at the end of 1960, provided the first early signs of the difficulties that peaceful teaching, peaceful coexistence would produce. Whilst previous attempts to teach it had received apathy and not great resistance, seminar teachers often complained that students weren't enthusiastic and many failed to turn up. The news of Lumumba's death, which reached the public in February, a report suggested that news of Lumumba's death, which reached the public in February, suggested that students had begun to question why, for example, Cuba received military support and the Congo hadn't. The Congo, one student noted, was left in the lurch by the socialist camp. In December 1961, India successfully invaded Portuguese Goa, leading one student to argue that peaceful coexistence would have led the Goan people into hating the Portuguese, and similar points were made about the ongoing bloody Algerian war. Things came to a head, however, in October 1962. The Cuban Missile Crisis was the focal point, but the second Sino-Indian border war also proved important. As Lorenz Luthi has shown, these parallel crises provided fuel to the fire that would eventually seal the Sino-Soviet rift in 1963. Particularly important here was the impression on the part of Mao that by the conclusion of the Cuban Missile Crisis, where Khrushchev had agreed to remove Soviet missiles from Cuba, that in doing so, Khrushchev had acted with weakness, and it was shortly followed by a Maoist propaganda campaign denouncing the Soviet withdrawal of missiles from Cuba. Evidence from end-of-term reports suggests that the majority of students shared Mao's viewpoint. The situation was deemed severe enough a crisis that the director of the school, Karl Kampfer, felt compelled to report it to the head of the trade union. Kampfer noted that whilst the experience of the cohort was generally successful, I quote, "since the events in the Caribbean, October 1962, we have been compelled to differentiate ourselves with a large number of opinions, which essentially stem from the fact that our students don't understand the politics of peaceful coexistence." The report listed a litany of complaints regarding Khrushchev and the Soviet Union. Immediately after the announcement of the withdrawal of Soviet rockets, many African students produced hefty criticisms of Soviet policy. The Soviet Union, they said, had not saved the peace, there was no danger of war, and instead the students saw that the Soviet Union had retreated in the face of the imperialists. And students often mention how GDR teachers had told them they were to trust imperialists and make deals with them, whereas this was exactly what the Soviet Union had done. The Soviet Union, they argued, was weaker now than it was in 1956 at the time of the Suez Crisis, and Khrushchev had let Kennedy blind him. Perhaps most damagingly, they argued that the Soviet Union had betrayed Cuba and, quote, delivered a terrible blow to all national liberation movements. In addition to this, a report noted that all of the students supported the Chinese position in the Sino-Indian War. So to kind of conclude and bring it back to this notion of socialist globalization, why do these debates matter? How do they kind of contribute to what we might talk about? There's something called socialist globalization. I think to answer this question, we need to reference the work of Jeremy Friedman, whose recent work on the Sino-Soviet split, what he calls the Shadow Cold War, has argued that the division between the Soviet Union and communist China was the result of two contrasting agendas: the anti-capitalist one on the part of the Soviets and the Chinese anti-imperialist revolution. In order to secure the support of the emerging global south, Friedman argues, the Soviet Union was forced to abandon many of its anti-capitalist principles, most notably its existence, which it found to be unpopular amongst the new leaders of the global south. By the late 1970s, Friedman notes, they had done so and seen off the Chinese threat to the mantle of leader of world revolution. But in order to do so, the Soviet Union had to, and I quote, replace peaceful competition and evolution of militant struggle, global class solidarity with racial and national identity, and domestic economic reform with promotion of international leadership initiative. The ideological debates of the early 60s, I contend, provide a sort of micro-history of the beginnings of this process. By rejecting peaceful coexistence, the Soviets' emphasis on anti-capitalism in favour of militant anti-imperialism, students were contributing to the Sino-Soviet split, and thus shifting the global left toward anti-imperialism. So my colleague Eric Burton revealed a joke that used to circulate among Tanzanians in the Cold War that was, if you want the capitalist, you need to send them to the Soviet Union or Cuba, but if you want the communist, you need to send them to study in a Western country. The joke plays on a widely observable truth regarding the unpredictability of center-periphery educational exchange, in particular its propensity to produce students with ideas hostile to their educators, and the largely Western educated leaders of the post-war, post-colonial movements, I think, are exemplars of this trend. But the real ideological battle of this institute in particular was not between capitalism and communism, but between Soviet and Chinese informed visions of global communism. The eventual Soviet victory over the Maoist challenge was a Pyrrhic one that ultimately contributed to Soviet demise. The experiences of the institute were, for the GDR, something of a paradoxical success. The school was supposed to help the GDR better understand the transformations in the global south. It succeeded in doing so, but instead of revealing a world that the GDR functionaries hoped they would find, the students revealed the comparative advantage with which anti-imperialism and Maoism was operating at the time. Similarly, the school was successful in its aim of producing creative and independent revolutionaries. There is little evidence that the students left as capitalists, but instead the institute appeared to produce a cohort of committed trade unionists who accepted many Soviet tenets but placed anti-imperialism ahead of anti-capitalism in their thinking. So globalization, as Anthony Giddens has noted, fragments as it coordinates. So bringing students to the global south, from the global south to Berlin, was meant to bind processes of decolonization closer to the socialist world and socialist trade unions in Africa closer to the GDR. On one level, the copious correspondence between former students and the schoolhouse and the federal archives proves that this binding was successful. But inasmuch as this new coordination produced bonds, the newfound ability of the students of the global south also accelerated fragmentation in the socialist world. And I think this was kind of one experience of many that led to this kind of sea change in Soviet and therefore GDR foreign policy. So in more ways than one, the institute was a precursor of things to come. Thanks.
George, for coming for such an interesting presentation. We can open the floor to questions if anyone would like to.
So it was a great presentation. I think it's a fascinating topic because, you know, we never get that, you know, the other side of globalization, especially in the whole Cold War aspect, you know, around China, around the Soviet Union, GDR. One observation, I thought it was pretty interesting when you said that the Soviet Union, how they were, the GDR, how they were, they supported the Vietnamese success, but at the same time threatened them. Mm-hmm. That's pretty interesting. You know, the whole lack of control of them in Cuba and so forth. So that, and I have another one question here. The Soviet-Sino split, how much do you think, you know, and that's pretty interesting also how they both, you know, as you pointed out, following a globalized path, you know, both of them. Was one more successful than the other? And two, how much did Nixon play into that? Is there, you know, the whole, you know, Nixon and China, the whole issue, how much did was that a factor?
Yeah, I think essentially what I think the evidence of the students in the school certainly proves is that it requires a kind of, in terms of who was most successful, it requires a kind of a narrative. Certainly, Maoism was more popular. I think there was kind of various aspects to that. I think on one side, there was the legacy of colonialism was never kind of far from people's minds. And as much as the socialist world attempted to kind of rid themselves of the legacies of colonialism, I think Maoism was always going to have an advantage, not coming from a country that previously had been a colonial force. But I think also, essentially, I don't think the Soviet Union really understood, really had a very good idea of what was happening in Poland itself. This is one of the legacies of Stalinism. So Stalin was kind of notoriously skeptical about the concept of revolution in the global south. When he did engage in kind of any kind of activity there, it was tended to be cynical. So therefore, decolonization, particularly in Africa, completely took the socialist world by surprise. On that basis, I think there was a kind of an attempt by these people, as you say, to kind of control these movements. Much more so with regard to Soviet policy aims, which were kind of very different from what the leaders of the new decolonized states were looking for. So certainly anti-imperialism, which was kind of associated with Maoism, was more popular. But I think over time, the Soviet Union kind of noticed this, these kind of experiences were formative in that regard. And eventually the Soviet Union kind of adopted the anti-imperialist stance, right? And I think it's interestingly something that we see kind of continues today. There's plenty of anti-imperialist movements as well. There aren't many anti-capitalist movements. So in a way the Maoists won, but eventually the Soviets won, if only because they subsumed the Maoist arguments. With regard to Nixon, essentially, I think the kind of Chinese anti-imperialist line ended in the mid-70s, after Mao and Chinese foreign policy completely shifted. So I think by that point, it really kind of changed.
Yeah, one thing I wanted to ask about was the continuation of like these connections after Germany reunites, because my name is Bernard. I work in Namibia, and I, before the project that I'm doing on agriculture now, I was doing oral histories of liberation movement, and a lot of these guys lived in East Germany for years. The East Germans set up a whole series of schools for Namibian children for think 12, 13 years, with the intention not so much of let's come give you a year or two of technical education, but let's raise them to be future socialist leaders in the country from childhood to your country is now independent, go rule it. As those people came back now, and after the reuniting of Germany and the sort of new forms of globalization, of aid and everything, those folks are the go-to people, which is ironic, because now this is a very sort of capitalist form of global development or aid or what have you, but they're tapping into now these previously socialist networks that were started by the GDR. Is that an exception or is that the rule? It may be an oddly specific question, but it's something that sort of your presentation sparked.
It depends where you are, I think. And it also depends on the nature, I think, of the kind of agreements and what was done. So you have
Mozambique, they had a similar school for Mozambican students.
So the story of Mozambique is really interesting because those kids, the state, so these are all kind of obviously like interstate deals that were made when those kids were sent back. So by the time they kind of graduated from school in the GDR, by the time they arrived back in Mozambique, the government, socialist government, had been overthrown. So there's an interesting book about those students in particular and their experiences, because very few of them were able to make anything of their education, and met a lot of them were trained, some of them were trained to be leaders, but some of them were trained in trades or engineering, for example. The Mozambican children were sent immediately into the army on their arrival in Mozambique. I think maybe a handful went back to Germany to study, but it was very difficult. It was particularly difficult for those students because, I mean, when the GDR cease to exist, the kind of their legal rights also cease to exist because they were interstate agreements. So it's actually been really hard for a lot of those people to continue their studies or even live in Germany. There are some kind of examples of people who do, but there are huge communities around the world of people who, a friend of mine was. I was doing some research in Zanzibar, which was when Zanzibar became the year it was independent before it joined Tanzania. It was one of the briefly recognised the GDR. So there was a lot of links between Zanzibar and GDR, and there's apparently a lot of German speakers left there. But these links don't really have any kind of official line of function.
It was a fascinating presentation. I come from Ethiopia, and I think shed light on the complexity of and the heterogeneity of the international socialist community. It has emerged there as well. For example, in Ethiopia, of course, GDR basis on supplying weapons, diplomatic and political support for the military Marxist regime. But there were rebels, who were fighting against that regime, who also labeled themselves as socialists and communists. And for them, the GDR and USSR are not socialists, so they labeled them as, they gave them all the names, and they had a lot of sympathy for them. They had the revolution betrayed narrative in them, and actually the major rebel group in Ethiopia, which is now in power. It's a search for symbol or a genuine socialist state. They look at Imre Hoxha of Albania as the true revolutionary socialist. So I think it's very interesting. My question is, how autonomous was GDR in pursuing this Sudan or from Ethiopia? Maybe a Lord or have further delivery, but what about, you know, for example, in the case of, you know, the USSR China conflict or other significant global issues?
Yeah, it's, thanks, it's a good question. I kind of weighed up whether or not to speak about this briefly. It's quite a difficult topic to define exactly. I mean, so in broad terms, they add very little freedom, right? So the kind of broad structures of the GDR foreign policy had to follow that of the Soviet Union. So precisely the Sino-Soviet split, for example, the GDR immediately, kind of as soon as it became official doctrine, the GDR immediately started reproducing Soviet material, anti-Maoist material. It was essentially a climate state. I'm not kind of international relations scholar, but there's been a lot of IR work on how to define this relationship. I think, look, within a broad framework, the GDR wasn't allowed to, it was obviously that's to a certain thing with the US, for example. But within a certain kind of broad framework, it did have its own kind of freedom to act. So, for example, I think their relationship with SWAPO was particularly interesting because it wasn't necessarily driven by the Soviet Union. It was kind of driven by this colonial history and particularly by SWAPO activists using kind of GDR anti-colonial rhetoric. Getting support. There's also quite a lot of evidence that, for example, the GDR supported Russia against Soviet wishes, or not necessarily against Soviet wishes, but it wasn't necessarily something that came from the Soviet Union that they were ordered to do.
So they had some level of independence and authority to initiate foreign policy.
Yeah, I mean, and one of the ways it worked was that, I mean, the GDR was constantly demanding, they were constantly in this kind of conflict with the Soviet Union with regard to raw materials, for example. The GDR relied on the Soviet Union for a lot of raw materials, and during, after the oil crisis, the Soviet Union stopped giving the GDR cheap oil, so they had to just kind of find their own ways of getting oil, and they would use kind of contacts abroad to kind of play the Soviets. They would say, if you don't supply us with oil, we'll kind of go here to go. So there was that kind of, within a kind of broad climate state relationship.
Thank you.
Any other questions?
Yeah, I have a question. What would you say the state, the legacy of this globalization is today? You know, because you look around, you have the whole thing. Concepts. What would you say the continuity or systems that are changing the time? What would you say the state is of this path?
On one level, partially because we know so little about these connections, the legacy is also kind of hard to detect. I think most interestingly for kind of today, for kind of the politics today, I think the battle of ideas over anti-imperialism versus anti-capitalism, I think today has very interesting conclusions. Kind of, I think that, if you look today, say for example, within the British left, for example, there's a certain quite a small section, but nevertheless, a section of the British left that supports Assad, for example, in the Syrian civil war, on the basis that he is an anti-imperialist. I think that kind of support, that kind of idea that anti-imperialism, regardless of politics, regardless of being socialist or anti-capitalist, is a virtue in and of itself and something worth defending, I think actually ultimately you can trace that all the way back to these debates and the global. I mean, it also has a huge effect today in Germany. There's a large Vietnamese community in Berlin in particular, who were descendants of contract workers who came to work in Germany in the 1980s. They kind of struggled to gain German citizenship after the decline of the GDR. And I think particularly actually, I think it kind of has a continuing effect in the way that Global South is viewed in Germany today. So a huge number of people who live in Germany today were educated under this system. Were brought to write birthday letters to Nelson Mandela, for example. It doesn't necessarily only have good legacy, I think. There's a lot of scholars who kind of pointed to. So there were huge race riots in the early 90s in Germany, and kind of rising far right, and a lot of racist rioting, particularly in Rostock in 1990, horrendous attacks on Vietnamese people in Brackley. And there's been quite a lot of work, scholars have said, kind of blamed the way that global socialist internationalism was taught in the GDR. That there wasn't much contact, there wasn't that much contact with people from the global south, but they were kind of given this kind of symbolic socialist internationalism, and that somehow people's kind of hatred of the government then kind of found this expression in a kind of turn to racism. I'm not so sure that actually that explains racism in Germany today, but there are people who say that.
I think somehow including all that question, I think ideologically, of course, socialism embraces diversity, and especially for Eastern Europe, including East Germany, it came in the aftermath of Nazism and Fascism. But in the after the fall of there was a hype, not only in DDR, but in post socialist social communities, societies. You would imagine a way somehow there was more, the indoctrination was not just that, unlike other countries which had actually colonial. Colonies, until the 70s, some of them the 80s. So, from nationalism perspective, I do understand that this rise with the strong state-related inclination of international solidarity and brotherhood is a narrative.
It's an immensely difficult question. Isn't necessarily, it's not necessarily specifically what I'm looking at. You certainly can't divorce this kind of notion of indoctrination and in a kind of subsequent kind of reaction to it after the end of the state. Mm-hmm. I don't think that is something that's, I think maybe that argument is overstated, but I think it's probably something that certainly exists. There's many things at play. I mean, particularly in East Germany, the reunification was very drastic. There was a kind of huge spike in unemployment after that on one level might have contributed to these kind of ideas. I think we have to remember, like that's the point I was trying to make about the imagery of the Vietnamese solidarity campaign. Whilst these states were depicted themselves and possibly genuinely saw themselves as anti-racist states, racism never went away from these places, particularly in places that had colonial legacies. So all of the students that came to study in the GDR were victims of racism. You know, there was certainly racist imagery at work, a lot of socialist internationalism, kind of racist ideas about development, internalism, European internalism. So in that regard, it never went away. So, I mean, its rise is kind of easy to explain in that sense. But it's difficult.
How exactly were the students selected that got to go to GDR? How were they recruited? Were there networks in place for them to get recruited? Sort of, were they being selected? How did it work exactly?
So they were, it essentially worked that trade unions, so it was organized by the trade union, so trade unions who, and this, the East German trade union kind of had various links with trade unions in the global south, particularly African trade unions, which was hugely important during the decolonization of German unions, activist movements. So they were made, the agreements were made through agreements between the East German trade union and the trade unions in the world. And it was kind of, there was some kind of vetting procedure, I think, by the foreign department in East Germany, which kind of sought to, I think, maximize the amount of students that would come from places they deemed to be politically important to the GDR. So, depending on the situation. So, I mean, the places the students came from kind of changed quite drastically throughout time. Because in the early 60s, it was mainly Africans. A lot of Vietnamese came later. So it was a mix of people who essentially applied through their trade unions. And then it was vouched by the foreign.
What seems interesting to me, of what you're saying, with how the donations, you said it was like 8%?
0.8%? Yeah,
okay. Well, what's interesting is, because in West Germany, most of the donations were taken through NGOs. And was there an NGO presence in East Germany? Because it seems like, from what you're saying, most of these donations to the Global South came through semi-mandatory trade union deductions or what, as opposed to the other side where it was strictly voluntary out of the workplace. Am I right in saying that there wasn't much NGO presence in East Germany?
No, there was none. So, I mean, NGOs, I mean, the leaders of GDR were told that NGOs are capitalists. Always of domination. Yeah, and they had a very strange, so the kind of main object of my study is the trade union, the GDR, which didn't really function as we would understand a trade union anywhere else to function. You know, whether it was like a strike, collective bargaining. Trade union was kind of like this, it was essentially a mass organization. It was a way of getting people to engage in the state.
Yeah.
So it was all done through the trade union. They had a foreign office, they didn't have a kind of any department for solidarity or department for aid or anything like that. So it all went for the trade union. But the trade union, so the solidarity committee that I mentioned, that was I mean, it was technically a kind of independent organization. It was completely people on it, but the members of the board were at the top of the SEP, the ruling party. So it was the state that. I mean, the state was kind of huge. And various levels going down.
And then did that create any degree of latitude solidarity between East Germans and West Germans on the level of shared values with regards to the global south? Because I know if you look at just West German foreign policy, it was by and large allied with most Western European and Western ideas about it. but you still have a lot of these anti-apartheid movements operating in West Germany as well. Was there, is that one of these legacies of it? Was there some sort of solidarity between East and West Germans over the global issues?
Not that I know of. And I mean, not that would ever have been announced by the GDR, because I mean, any West German solidarity initiative, even if it was anti-apartheid,
must be viewed through that lens.
Yeah. They did engage the anti-apartheid movement, in particular, about the GDR to engage. So the GDR was one of the most important members of the UN anti-apartheid committee. And there was a lot of kind of cooperation with Scandinavian countries, for example.
Yes, yes.
Quite important anti-apartheid movements in Europe, certainly more so.
And it's interesting, because the Scandinavians, they kind of did this little like hybrid of the East German and West German model, by which the trade unions in Scandinavia were some of the big supporters of the anti-apartheid movement, but there were also all these NGOs coming in. It's sort of like that was the hybrid.
I've kind of struggled with ways to kind of define that the trade union actually really functions. It's so difficult to describe, since so unlike anything else. But on one level, it was like a kind of forced NGO. Right? It was an NGO that you had to be a part of, essentially.
That's interesting.
Please.
Hi.
Hi.
This session is about
as far as I know, so the archive that I've looked at is the kind of internal documents of the school. I think what's quite interesting about these students is that they were in many ways kind of privileged members of the GDR, in that they were, as far as I know, there were no kind of negative consequences of these opinions. There were a few very isolated incidents where people were sent home that came up in the archives. They were quite rare, and they tended to be not necessarily about ideas, but kind of what they kind of deemed bad behaviour or something. So there was a surprising amount of leeway, at least. As I said, looking in the archive, there's no kind of evidence of there's, they, I mean, they certainly wouldn't have been kind of sent to prison or charged criminal actions for voicing these opinions. Generally there was a lot of concern that they were criticising the Soviet Union, and there were a lot of attempts to make them stop doing it. But generally, they seemed to be kind of, it wasn't kind of the general practice of criminalizing them. So, for example, a lot of these students used to travel to West Berlin. And what I thought was quite interesting was that there were a lot of meetings where they tried to get them to stop, and told them to stop going to West Berlin, but they didn't seem able to stop them. And I would have thought that by that time, it was like, it would have been easy to stop them. Seeing there was a kind of respect for their rights within that kind of particular regard of freedom of expression. Yeah. But I mean, they certainly would have been spied on.
One explanation that I can think of is that it was like symbolic of the socialist nationalism, and like imprisoning them for having taken severe actions kind of show that the project failed.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I think also, there was this, the way they presented it was as if it was a genuine, they said, this is a kind of genuine movement, we're creating, we're educating people to be genuine, we're independent, creative, revolutionaries. No one wants to kind of necessarily ruin that. Although, there were some isolated cases of people who left, went on to write publications in West European or American press criticizing it and saying there was like an element of control. But I've not come across any criminalizing. I certainly will at some point access the Stasi archives, and that might shed more light on that. But from the archives that I've read, it seems like that wasn't really.
All right, can we get another round of applause?